What did you do?
Charles, the world is not the same as it was. Mutants. They're gone now.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real.
Where is she?
Beneath the stains.
She's like you.
Of time.
Very much like you.
The feelings disappear.
She needs our help.
You are
someone to come along.
Someone has come along.
I am still right here. And you could have it all. My empire of dirt. I will let you down. I will make you hurt.
Hello and welcome everyone to the March review, fucking Logan, because we're going to fucking review this fucking awesome movie.
Fuck yeah.
Freaking let's do it, alright man? Yay, now it's not spiking so much.
Sounds good.
We're solid. Take five.
Yes.
Click. So, first we're going to give out our plugs, because we forget to do this shit, so no one cares anyway.
Yeah, and we're not sure if you even make it to the end of our podcast, so you got to hear this at the beginning.
Yep, here comes the plugs. Make sure you like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube page, at Comic Movie Marks. We put on two videos, like, yesterday, I think, like a month and a half old. Yeah. So, we got about a three-month period before we add shit.
And slowly it's in bulk, coming back.
And it's in bulk.
Yes, exactly.
See, isn't that nice? You get Comic Movie Marks podcast in bulk.
Yeah.
It's got to wait 3 months.
It's like the streaming service, you know, it's constant. What do they call that?
Like Netflix and shit.
Yeah, series? Yeah, where you can binge listen. Yeah, that's the word I was looking for.
So make sure you binge listen to all our terrible podcasts at Comic Movie Marks on YouTube.
Oh yeah, and be sure to follow us on social media: Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. We do a little bit better job updating that. I say little bit.
Poquito.
Yes.
In honor of Logan.
Nice. I like it. You can also send us questions, comments, concerns to comicmoviemarks@gmail.com. Be sure to send us all. Everything. If just
we actually,
send it.
If we actually hit 28 subscribers, we'll do a questionnaire. Currently, we're at 27.
There we go.
You can email us questions and we'll answer them. It doesn't matter what the questions is, whatever your you think we want, or whatever your thoughts are, whatever you want, and you want to ask us what our thoughts are on whatever fucking yep. movie, even if I haven't seen it, I'll give my thoughts on it.
Yeah, exactly. Suggestions on possibly future
so
reviews.
So get those subscribes up to 28. And you then know? We'll do a questionnaire.
Just subscribe for your mom or something.
Yeah, make up Gmail accounts. Who gives a shit at this point? No one cares. YouTube doesn't care. No one else cares. Make sure you hit that notification button so you know when our three-month binge listening yes. podcast come in.
Yes.
You'll be the first to hear it.
That's key. That's key.
All right. Now let's review Logan. This is Fox Marvel. This is their second rated R Marvel movie in their little X-Men universe.
I think they should just stick to this. We'll get to that part, but wow.
Yeah. So we're going to try something a little different. It's not going to last very long. It probably won't ever happen again, but we're going to do some non-spoiler talk.
Won't ever happen again. We're going to try.
Because I can see people being on the fence about this movie, whether or not they want to see it, and maybe they do want to hear like some non-spoiler opinions about the movie and what people thought, or what we thought. Maybe.
Yes.
Who knows? Maybe they're people. Who cares? Our 28th subscriber. Maybe he's got a good point.
Yeah.
Or she.
Yeah, exactly.
Or whatever it wants to be called.
Right.
Since you have to call them by gender-specific titles now.
Thank you. That's PC.
I'm all about PC and getting censored. Fucker. I want to make fun of a fat guy in Sacramento, and I can't. It's bullshit. So, first, we'll start off, actually, in our non-spoiler. We'll give our Rotten Tomatoes review, because they're always so great. Even then, they're still wrong on this one. They only gave it a 93%. What the fuck is wrong with them?
Wow. They are wrong on every time on so many levels. Congratulations.
Audience score is 95. They're correct.
Yes.
And their critic consensus from Rotten Tomatoes. I'm sure they're going to use a word here that I don't normally use. So, because they like using fun, joyless words.
Right.
Hugh Jackman makes the most of his final outing as Wolverine with a gritty, nuanced performance. See, I don't use that word. Nuanced performance in a violent but surprisingly thoughtful superhero action film that defies genre conventions.
Nice. I like it.
It's beautiful. God damn it. Their critic consensus suck. I swear.
Every time.
They don't tell you anything about the movie. They just make up shit as they go. That could go for any movie.
Right.
Any movie that's above 90%, you could just change out the fucking words.
Right.
A couple words there and boom. They just...
I'm sure that's what they do. We'll just pull it from this one.
It's a 93? All right, we got this. We got five different fucking versions we can type out.
Yeah. All right. Exactly.
Let's put it out there.
Yeah. So on IMDb, it got an 8.7 out of 10. Metascore, 77, whatever the hell that means.
Cool.
So, yeah.
Awesome. Go Metascore.
Yeah.
Now I know why Rotten Tomatoes is so popular. Because Metascore doesn't make any fucking sense. Currently, right now, according to Box Office Mojo, we got Logan is currently sitting at $85 million for opening weekend.
$1 million. All right.
$1 million. So, for a rated R movie, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
You got to love that. It's not Deadpool numbers, but it's still pretty good.
Yeah.
I'm a tad bit surprised. I really thought it was going to break over 100.
Yeah, me too. Opening weekend, for
especially
sure.
How hard it was to get tickets for it. Like, that was just that was a bitch. It was just as hard as pretty much any other big movie, budget movie that we've been watching lately.
Yeah, the theater we were in, it was chock full of people.
Yeah. We live in the, we got the luxury theater, so everybody comes there. So yeah, it's really nice.
Maybe that's why.
Yeah, we got our luxury
chairs. That was everyone.
We got
our town.
We got our confusing popcorn. We piss off the guys behind the counter.
And then eventually realized that we misordered.
Yeah. When he was right the whole time.
Yep.
He told us to get a medium to split it all.
Yeah.
And we were like, no, we'll do two smalls, asshole.
Fucking tell us how to order. Save money. He's like, all right, jackasses.
Yeah, and that was all that 16-year-old kid was right.
Yes, exactly.
And then I find out one guy didn't even like popcorn. That was
even though he's the one who wanted one of the smalls.
Yeah. Give me a small popcorn. Here you go. Oh, I really like popcorn. Wait, what?
Get stuck in my teeth.
That's the most confusing thing.
Okay.
We were walking in there very confused.
Yeah. Oh.
Here we go. Here's our attempt at non-spoiler Logan review. Can you fucking believe they blew up the whole planet? This is fucking ridiculous.
It's just insane.
How else do you end in a fucking movie like this? Yeah. Now what are they going to do? X-Men can't exist after this now.
Nobody can.
Now we already know. 2029, X-Men's done. Okay, that's not what happened. Close, though. Very, very close.
Yes.
Now, so I'm going to start off with, it's rated R. It earns its R by far. It is a definitely beautiful R movie, and I loved it. Every aspect of it. We got a little bit of a teaser that's going viral in the beginning for Deadpool.
Yeah.
So there's that to check out. If you love Deadpool, this might even be worth the price of admission.
I've worked so hard in this life to let someone...
Oh, you want to end up dead?
No, no, please don't hurt me.
Are you fucking kidding me?
No. Not on my watch, motherfucker.
You want to die right now?
Don't die! Hey, don't fucking look at me!
I'm not fucking... No, I'm not fucking... God, shut up!
Wow, nice suit.
Zip it, Stanley.
I can see the new horizon underneath the blazing sky. I'll be with the eagles flying higher and higher.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, that's not good. No, no, no. Oh, you're not going to walk that one off. Oh, that's so gross. Oh, I'm so sorry. I spent way too long in the phone booth. If I'm being honest with myself, I probably should have just called 911. Well,
matters now. Because I think we're both missing a real point here. The fuck is a phone booth doing on a street corner? Didn't those disappear in 98? I suppose I could have just used my cell. Don't you think? Ooh! And Cherry Garcia ice cream. You gonna eat this? Don't answer now. Just rest.
I mean, actually, I made a call. It was to the costumer. His name is Laird. He usually helps me put the suit on.
I don't know how the other guys do it so quickly.
You know, he probably wouldn't be dead if it was Logan. What has he got to change into? Guy wears a fucking tank top and a pair of jeans. Yeah, like to get my tank top on, bit of perspiration, have a nice little crime-fighting spree, yeah. Happy hugger call a day.
Fantastic, even though it is on YouTube, but it actually is a different version.
It is. It is a slightly different version.
There's different choices of music and mm-hmm. different dialogue going on at yeah. some points.
Different characters, I guess.
Yeah. And there is the different points in this that little Deadpool teaser. The movie starts out with Logan just fucked up. He's yep. just, this dude is done. He's old. He's sick. He's fucked up. And he's near Mexico, so he's really fucked up, which really sucks.
Yeah.
It's in a story about how mutants have been, for the most part, there hasn't been any mutants born. There's no natural mutants anymore mm-hmm. in this post-apocalyptic mutant world.
Yeah.
I guess you would say. It seems like everything else is running just fine. You know, it's doing just great, as we see with Logan now as a limo driver.
Yeah.
Which is hilarious.
That's pretty sweet.
But it you see that everything is still running fairly normal. It's just without mutants. And like even the news acknowledges that, like, why are we even talking about them anymore? This is definitely a different movie than we've ever seen from the X-Men. Like,
yeah.
Even, you know, it's so much different. It's so much different. And the process in which they go through each point, this road trip that ultimately they go on, it's pretty hard on you. Like, there's no happy points.
Yeah.
it's not necessarily doom and gloom, but it's done in a way where it still can be a little bit fun, but it's also fairly chaotic as well.
Yeah. Yep. And I think that's what keeps you just locked into this movie. As Matt touched on, as Matt said before, it's just really well done. And there's parts when you're going on this whole adventure, I guess if you want to call it, it keeps you engaged the entire time. Even in some parts that you would consider a lull in the movie, you're engaged waiting for what happens next. One of my favorite parts about this movie is the dialogue is very important, I feel like, in almost the entire movie itself. And so you want to stay paying attention, and it just draws you in. Other than the fact that I had to piss, I could have kept going with this movie.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, eventually, yeah. That's what happens when you drink a little bit of popcorn, or eat a little bit of popcorn and drink a lot of liquid.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I did have to piss, too. Yeah, and you're old. I did have to piss, and they were talking about pissing a lot in this movie, so it kind of made you want to piss more. But ultimately, Logan, it doesn't even necessarily have to be called a superhero movie. There's just superhero aspects to it.
Right.
It's not, there's just above normal people abilities going on.
Yeah.
And it takes very little from the old man Logan. I mean, almost nothing really, other than the fact that he's on a road trip and he's old. Right. That's about it. But there's another comic book, which is escaping me right now, that it takes a little bit more from, about where Wolverine fights kind of a different aspect, different things and stuff like that. I almost gave a spoiler. So that's why that sounded retarded right now. So I cut myself off. Ultimately, we're going to say you definitely have to go see this.
Yes.
Watch it in theaters. See it on the biggest, nicest screen with the biggest sound you can. IMAX, whatever you can. They don't have it in 3D, so that's a plus.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. That's always an A+ in my book. I definitely want to go see it again. I don't know how we're going to fit it into our schedule.
Yeah, I don't know.
I was actually looking at today to go watch it again. I was 50-50 on it. There was some Atmos openings. So
oh, nice.
It was tempting.
Yeah,
was tempting,
I think that was the one drawback for me that I noticed just early part of the movie. And this has nothing to do with the movie. It was just the sound and our theater, even though they're luxury theaters. I was kind of like, oh, this is off. a little bit. And yeah, definitely see it in an Atmos version. One of my favorite parts about this is it actually lived up to what everyone was saying. There's been so many movies that people are giving it, you know, a 9.8 out of 10, a 10 out of 10, an 11 out of 10 or whatever.
Doctor Strange.
Yeah, pretty much. Not just Doctor Strange. There's been a lot of movies where I'm like, it's not quite lived up to that hype.
Batman.
yeah, exactly. So going into this, to me, it lives up to the hype, which we'll get into more details about what we loved about the movie. But you definitely have to go see it. It's phenomenal.
I was just going to say this real quick. You know, for me, this movie really shows me that there's a world out there in comic book movies that is untapped.
Yep.
Or I think it was briefly tapped in with certain movies, and it's just never been completely utilized. But Fox right now, what they're doing with their rated R comic book hero movies is better than anything DC, Warner Brothers, or Marvel, Disney can produce to me right now.
Yeah.
Like, they're not even on the same page. Like, I don't know, that's just because my age and what I prefer, but that's just what I'm doing right. That's what I'm feeling right now, is that those ones don't even, you can't even compare. Like, I think Batman versus Superman could have been a little bit better if it was actually rated R, not that bullshit they pulled with the DVD.
Yeah, and I could see where, I guess after seeing this movie, where more of where Batman versus Superman fell short, I guess, in that they were trying to toe a line instead of deciding we are going to be R and this is why. They were trying to toe the line of PG-13 versus R, and there are certain things that they did that were a little bit more adult. I felt the emotion in Batman versus Superman, but they really just pull it out of you in Logan.
I think the violence and some of the tone can't meet, or the violence in some of the dialogue can't meet the tone of Batman versus Superman.
Right.
And because it's PG-13.
Mm-hmm.
And even their fake rated R shit they put out on DVD, which was a total lie and total bullshit.
A little bit more blood, I guess. It's not quick cuts.
Like one middle finger and maybe a couple fucks. Yeah. It was stupid. It wasn't warranted at all. But I think that really showed me that there's a level in which superhero movies can be made and done. And Fox is doing it right now. Yeah. And they're my favorite right now. Like, this just to kind of give an overall summary of our non-spoiler part here, which we did fairly good, I think.
Yeah.
This has definitely moved up into my top six best comic book movies.
Yeah.
It's knocking out. Fox is owning two spots now in that area, maybe even three with a couple other movies, but this is right. This is what some, you can't do this with all.
Obviously. No, but it also shows
it would be awesome to have a rated R Ant-Man though.
Yes. It also shows perfect segue. A lot of people before this movie came out, they were begging for Marvel to take over, similar to what they did with Superman, or Disney, I should say, Disney's Marvel to take over the X-Men side. After this movie, no. I could see a Fantastic Four movie done this way. If they want to go, you know, more gritty emotion and full rated R, hell yeah. You know, let's see it. They just need to do that for a lot of their movies. Because obviously right now, toeing the line isn't working for them. And I really don't want to see that drastic of a shift going to the Disney side, unless we see Wolverine in his suit.
That wouldn't work at all. Disney couldn't handle these properties at all or do what they want to do. They would just be generic as fuck.
Mm-hmm.
Then we would just have some white bread Avenger style stuff. It wouldn't work. It just wouldn't make sense. Maybe it would be fun, whatever you want to call it. Maybe it'd be joyful.
Yes, what everyone's looking for.
But this is so much better. This is what. I mean, whatever. There's some things that kids probably shouldn't see, but I think kids should see it. That's just my opinion. I just think this is more what people should be watching than the fucking fruity-tooty Avengers shit. And I don't know. It's just, this is what I fucking grew up on. I watched Terminator 2 and RoboCop. Right. This is what made me, all right?
Now you all get it.
That shit was awesome. You know, back in the day when they used to fucking promote rated R movies to kids, that was the best. The Attitude Era of wrestling was promoted to kids and toys and shit. It was fantastic. That's the time. That's what everybody needs. You need that little bit of weird shit in your life. You need to see a guy get his hand blown off or something, or RoboCop, and you need to you just need to see some of that shit sometimes, you know, every once in a while.
Yeah.
Anyway,
somewhat.
So overall, we highly recommend, both Shane and I both highly recommend to go see Logan.
Yes.
Watch it multiple times if you truly enjoy it. Give it the respect and the money it deserves.
Yep.
For producing a really, really, really good comic book movie.
Yep.
So now we're going to get into spoilers. And I'm surprised it took us that long.
Yes.
We did a really good job. Please email us and let us know how great we did.
Yes, how great we are.
Hit us up on Instagram-o. So, now spoilers. Holy shit, the world fucking blew up. I could not believe that.
Yes. Oh, man.
Everybody died. It was fantastic.
Yes. It was fantastic.
That's the way to end a fucking movie.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to bust into the likes and dislikes of Logan. Shane, go ahead.
So, just to touch on a little bit of the stuff that we talked about in our non-spoiler portion, I loved the rated R aspect of this. Was phenomenal. There, I love when movies, and it did this on so many levels, but when a movie sucks you in so much that you forget where you're at. And I had reactions to some of the killings that, and I had to like pull myself back. Because I was like, oh, shit, I'm still in a public environment. But it was phenomenal. Definitely earns its R rating. I love the gore. I thought I didn't know a whole lot about, now I totally forgot the number, X-23.
Yeah.
Of the Laura, I didn't know a whole lot about her. So it was a surprise to me when the toenail, I guess, or the toe claw comes out.
The toenail.
And she spins it around and, you know, puts it through a guy's chin. And yeah, that was fantastic. I love that side of this movie. I said this when we left the theater, but this movie to me had everything that I would want to see in a movie, except for Superman, even though we got a little bit you know, with Deadpool.
With the Deadpool teaser, so we'll go into a little bit more about that.
Yeah.
So in the theatrical version, the music, the Richard Donner score is actually the old John Williams, right?
Yeah.
The score from the Donner movies is playing, and it's pretty fucking loud during that. I don't think he makes the phone call.
No.
In the theatrical version.
No, I don't remember that part.
The one that's going around. The music continues to play even after he gets out of the phone booth.
Yeah, which I liked that.
Yeah, because
that
when he's going to sprint, it's dun da da.
Yeah. Like Superman would do, and it's shot in that same, like, the angle that he's running is how Superman runs.
So the gay song that they're playing now, I'm not quite even sure, just one of those old 80s songs.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so.
Like whatever the hell it's in.
Yep.
And then Stan Lee is in this one that is going around the internet. He wasn't in the one in the theatrical version.
And I don't even remember what he says, but I do remember Deadpool.
Nice suit.
Nice suit. That's right.
Nice suit. Shove it, Stan Lee.
Yeah.
And so he takes off.
Yeah.
So that wasn't in that. But also, the music was different when he first walks up to him as Wade Wilson. When he's listening to it, he's listening to the old Salt and Pepper song. Or no. No, is he listening to the Salt and Pepper?
In the theatrical version?
Yeah, in the theatrical version, it was a different song. It was either the Salt and Pepper song that he was playing in the beginning of, I think, yeah, I'm pretty sure it was the Salt and Pepper song, Push It, or
not yeah,
Push
It.
No, what's the other
it
one?
It was.
Damn it.
They have like two popular songs.
Yeah, I can't remember the second one. Damn it. Anyway, so he was listening to that, and then just some of the dialogue when he was talking to the dead old guy, when he's laying on him. You know, he's talking about Wolverine in his costume, and but then I don't think the theatrical version had him doing the Australia accent and like wrestling a koala and shit.
Yeah,
like that.
I don't remember.
But I remember him going like, "Oh, brain freeze," because he's eating the guy's ice cream and shit. So it was.
Are you gonna eat that? Yeah.
And I feel like also I couldn't notice it that well. I don't know if it's because I was looking at it on my phone, but before you could see the theater really well, and it says like Logan, and then there's like a poster on the background. I couldn't see the poster this time.
Yeah.
I don't know if this way they cut it this time or what, but I don't know if it was just because I was looking on a tiny phone compared to a big ass screen before.
I don't even remember looking for that part, but I do remember seeing the Logan when he's in the phone booth. You could see Logan, you know, coming out. That was in both versions. So.
Oh, okay. So it was there. Oh, okay.
Now, I don't know about the poster.
Yeah, there was a movie poster when he's talking to the dead guy.
Yeah, in the alley.
Yeah. So that was fantastic. Deadpool Tool 2 looking.
Yeah, not soon enough.
Yeah,
I
not
agree.
Soon enough. They're banking on that to save Fox.
Yeah, pretty much.
So now we'll talk. We'll go back to Logan.
Yeah. Okay. So, but what I was saying is, other than not having Superman in this movie, it's everything that I can want in a movie: the gore, the action, the emotion, even the subtle humor. I don't need overly done humor. It was perfect in this, just enough to where, you know, you chuckle at certain parts. Even spoilers at this part, but even once Logan dies. And she's...
What? The fuck, man? You just do that to me.
I've never seen this. But the part that I laughed at was when the Laura girl is, she's just talking like any English words that she could remember. Yeah. Some of it came from the Shane movie,
yeah,
which was perfect. But and so that made me laugh. You know, it was in a very like emotional part.
No more guns in this house.
Yeah.
And she's just repeating everything back from
right. Yeah, so it's fantastic. And then they don't even know what to say. They're like, okay, the rest of the kids. And then they just leave.
They just burn ass out of there, leave her there crying.
Yeah.
What a team.
Right.
Anyway, you know, this movie starts off, earns its R almost right in the beginning. You know, you could tell, you could look at Wolverine. He's asleep in a fucking limo. And he's doing a limo service with a nice Cadillac. By the way, they had the American car trifecta. I did like that. First, they had the Cadillac. Oh, yeah. Then they had the Dodge. And then he had the old Ford.
Right.
At the end.
Yeah.
So you had the American car trifecta. Yeah. So congratulations.
Yeah. Good job. Good product placement.
Yeah. You spread out America, even though he's Canadian and the actor is Australian. Right, so, yeah. And the second main guy is English.
So. I can't be the only one that was worried they were going to start having transmission problems on the Ford.
Oh. Well, that one's the only one that made it.
Yeah.
Did you hear me when the Dodge couldn't start?
Yeah.
I was like, that's what happens when you buy a Dodge. Yeah. And he's out there beating it with a shovel. Like,
fuck. I'm sure a lot of Dodge owners feel that way too.
Oh, dude, that is like a poster board right there. We should be over at Dodge dealership. Fuck. The humor in this movie, this is the way it needs to be done.
Yes.
Like, Deadpool is fine, because that's references, pop culture, that's fourth wall breaking.
Right.
That's different.
Yeah.
That's different comedy. That's how that character is. But when you're having a serious tone movie, somewhat like Batman v Superman, where they did have subtle humor like this, not as much as this, and not as good as this, but still subtle. It was two guys talking shit back and forth to each other for the most part through half the movie.
Yeah.
And it was other guys talking shit to each other. This is what guys, most guys, do. They talk shit. Like, you know, when he's putting him in the bathroom because he's got a piss. Don't fucking watch. Not like I fucking watch anyway. Like,
exactly.
It's two guys just like they're it could be father-son type situation. It could just be the best friends possible situation. Right. Mentor and student, whatever you want to call it.
Mm-hmm.
The tightest bond possible.
Yeah.
And it's just two guys just talking unbelievable amounts of shit to each other.
Yeah, and it was perfect. It wasn't over the top. Yeah. It wasn't too little. It didn't feel awkward. It was at perfect moments of the movie, and it was just really well done. Phenomenal. I agree. This is how it needs to be done.
I don't know why, but this, because as they're traveling, because we're going to talk a little bit about the story, but from what happens is that from a border city in near Mexico, I'm not quite sure where he's at, but he's in some kind of border city in America doing his chauffeur job.
El Paso, Texas. Yeah.
I couldn't remember if I did see El Paso or not. Yeah. Or not. Okay. So it was, and then he goes over into Mexico to where he's living.
Yeah.
So he's traveling across the border nonstop all the time. And so a Canadian citizen going between America and Mexico.
Right.
I don't think that would work very well. Not with Trump. You look a little suspicious. But, so he's traveling back and forth to take care of Professor X, who's completely gone batshit crazy. He's lost all capabilities for the most part. And he has some abilities to control his powers, but he just has constant seizures.
Yeah.
He's just, he's really fucked up. So whatever is happening to the mutants, whatever happened to him, and all you get really, and this is kind of, they didn't over-explain things, which is somewhat nice, but at the same time, a little bit of like, then this could go into a little bit of negative, but you just hear, I can't remember if it's Pierce or Price, Donald Pierce or Price or something like that. He, the bad guy, the doctor in this thing.
Oh, yeah.
He just kind of says that he released some kind of pathogen or something like that, that it started eliminating the mutant gene.
Yeah, it was Pierce.
Yeah, Pierce. Yeah. Okay. And
no, the doctor.
Oh, what's the doctor?
The doctor was Dr. Rice.
Oh, right.
And then, yeah.
I mixed them. Price.
Yeah. Yeah, the Pierce guy
is... the guy with the cyborg hand.
Yeah, yeah, okay. There you go.
All right. He's the Reaver character. Okay, so... So Rice, he talks about how he released some kind of pathogen or whatever to eliminate the mutant gene, so you can't be born with it anymore. So that's why we haven't had mutants born in a long time.
Right.
And so it was never really explained how he did it and if it how much it affects mutants, current mutants. Because it made me feel like, well, maybe that's what's wrong with Professor X. Maybe that's actually... Because even though Logan says he thinks it's the animanium that's poisoning him, I was wondering maybe if this pathogen is what's killing his healing factor. I was trying to figure out if it was supposed to be either one. If he was for sure it was the metal, the animanium, or if it was this pathogen or whatever the hell happened.
Right. They kind of leave that more up to interpretation. Yeah. And we were even texting back and forth a little bit because I was questioning how he – I know he ages still and it's very slow, but I thought at some point in The Wolverine they touched on – it was like towards the end when he was getting, you know, some of the youth sucked out of him or whatever by the Japanese guy. I kind of tied it to, okay, that's why he's old. But they don't, a lot of it is kind of up for interpretation, which that is one of my dislikes. Like you said, there were a couple parts that aren't over explained, which can be good. But in certain parts, it was a little, I don't want to say detrimental, but it left me wondering, like, what is going on here?
Yeah. I would actually lean more towards this. I keep calling him a pathogen. I'm not quite sure what exactly he said. He said he just released something. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to keep calling him a pathogen because that makes sense to me. but I would believe it would be more of that. That's what's fucking up Xavier. Yeah. And that's what. And then we get a small hint in a radio broadcast after the casino scene where he's seizuring and fucks everybody up. That, you know, seven mutants died a year ago in Winchester.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Logan shuts that off real quick. And then Xavier kind of talks about it a little bit, like he finally remembers what happened.
Mm-hmm.
So you get this little bit of an emotional scene of what's going on. So it sounds like he toasted a couple X-Men.
Right.
And I feel like that would have to do something with this pathogen or something like that that's fucking everything up.
Yeah.
That's why it just started wiping people out. And I think that's more of what actually is affecting Logan more than he thinks it's the metal, the animanium. Right. I wanted to go back to what I was talking about. So they were doing this road trip, right? And I don't know why, but this was probably the funniest thing to me. One of the funniest things. I don't know. I'm still laughing about it. But because they're traveling up north from Mexico, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is what makes it funny. Because they came from Mexico and they're heading up north.
Right.
And then it's like, and Logan's like, we need to keep pushing. And Professor X just looks at him and just, he's like, I'm not a box of avocados, you know?
Yeah. That was fantastic.
I don't know why, but I was laughing nonstop because it came from Mexico.
Right. It it's perfect.
Mexican avocado. Yeah. It's just beautiful. It made me laugh. And again, to the humor of the movie, it worked very, very well.
Mm-hmm.
It's just something that two guys would say to each other, and especially two guys that close at this point.
Yeah, exactly. One of the things that I really enjoyed about this, I felt like all of the supporting characters had important roles. You had, I can't remember the guy's name, but the person that Stephen Merchant played, and he was the...
the tracker?
Yeah, the tracker. Caliban. Yeah.
I want to keep saying Colt Man. Caliban, yeah.
Colt Cabana. Yeah, Caliban. I thought he was a great character. I thought the villains or heels or whatever you want to call them in this, I thought all of them were fantastic. They pull the right amount of anger out of you to where you can't wait to see them get theirs.
Especially when you watch some of that footage that the woman, the nurse, Gabriel, was taking of the facility, the Mexico Alkali Lake, whatever, transforming whatever facility, whatever the hell it was called. And you see some of the footage and how they're treating them and stuff like that, treating these kids and stuff like that. You know, it's meant to really push you to like, fuck, these guys are really shitty people.
Yeah.
And they're trying to make super soldiers, which is very similar to what Deadpool storyline was making these soldiers. So I kind of feel like there's a little bit of a tie in there.
Yeah.
That they're going to try to, I don't know, maybe they'll exploit in Deadpool 2 or maybe another X-Men movie after this one or before this one. I'm not quite sure what they would do. But then we have the X-23 character herself.
Yeah.
See, I hate kids. I hate kid actors. And I especially hate kid actors because they're annoying. And I always felt like they're a crutch in a movie to make the superhero or the older sibling or the older person have a weakness.
Yeah, which, I mean, that is no everyday life. If you have kids, I guess I should say. Anyways, continue.
No, it just always seems like dumb situations to put this kid in harm and stuff like that. Even though he still does try to protect her, which it, there's a couple parts that made me laugh, because even though he's all juiced up and everything on that shit, on that shit, he's like, get behind me. I'm like, bitch, she's got a better healing factor than you do.
Yeah, well, and what was awesome is he takes a couple, like, pretty solid bullets, and then she jumps over him.
Yeah, fuck you.
Yeah, and then they start, like, teaming up. That was one of the best parts. Oh, yeah. That was fucking phenomenal.
So she wasn't a crutch in this, and I loved it. And she barely talked, and I loved it. And, like, and you know, there's no love interest in this movie, which usually drags a movie down. It is point A to point B, road trip, and fighting and just persevering through all these difficult tasks.
Right.
I actually thought this was kind of interesting with the X-23 character, because they were in Mexico City. She really, her English seems to be limited, and, or I don't know actually how much her English is limited, but she was saying a lot of different Spanish terms. And even when they were showing the video of the Mexico facility, there was a lot of Spanish, and they didn't do any translations. No subtitles. At first, it was kind of like, well, I want to know what they're saying. But at the same time, I'm like, well, it's not a bunch. That would be kind of stupid to have text going across during a cell phone video. Like, I mean, it would just kind of seem weird, even though I know the text is for us and the cell phone video is for the movie. Like,
right.
I understand that, but I was kind of thinking about, like, text right now going across the screen in this type of movie would be really annoying.
Yeah, I'm sure it would take you out a little bit, unless there are certain things. I don't speak a lick of Spanish, so unless there was something like the part where she's chewing out Logan in the car, you know, and he goes, "Oh, you can talk," and she just starts rattling off, you know, different things. Unless there was something that was, you know, she's cussing or something like that.
No, she wasn't.
Okay, so that would have been hilarious to know. But
I know some Spanish. I'm very limited. I know the basics, and I know pretty much all the cussing. So right. I got most of those. But no, she was just pretty much saying, "We need to go here. We need to go here."
Yeah, okay.
And that's pretty much all she kept saying over and over again. It was that we need to go here, this and that, and then you're dying. But then they kind of had her do the trope where she says the sentence in Spanish and then says it again in English.
Yeah.
So that way they avoided the subtitles.
Right. But in that spot when she's just going off on him, I don't know if you could have a bunch of subtitles going up, to your point.
Right.
It'd kind of take away from that. It'd be kind of
weird. You'd take away from what she's trying to do and how Logan's reacting, which was another funny moment, because the whole time she hasn't talked. And he's like, "You can talk?" And she's just going like, "Shut up!" Like,
he's freaking out
on her because he wants her to shut up now. She's been quiet through the whole fucking thing.
Well, he gets pissed because she can talk, and then he wants her to shut up because she's talking too much.
Exactly. Yeah, no, that type of subtle humor. Like, that's just fantastic.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Ultimately, with this movie, I feel like what they did with this was it made a very basic, you know, it wasn't the end of the world. It was one guy trying to redeem himself. Trying to, you know, as, you know, like in Star Wars, hope again. And you kind of see it. There's these pockets where they start feeling a little bit better. They start enjoying things, like when they're watching the movie, Shane.
Right.
And you know, Professor X is sitting there on the bed, and she's sitting there, and she's just eating. And, you know, it's kind of this bonding moments. And then when they're in the Black family and stuff like that, it's real bonding moments and how she does, because she's totally, she's not social at all. She's just staring at the guy's face, getting really close to him while he's trying to listen to music and shit. Yeah, you could just have this.
Sure, the way she's eating, he like has to use the fork and, you know.
She's just shoveling shit.
Yeah, she was like grabbing mashed potatoes or something with her hands and just throwing them in her mouth. So
yeah, it was definitely a very up and down movie. It had the moments where you start seeing them unite a little bit and then things happen, chaos and ensues because these people are trying to hunt him down. You know, one of the funny things for me was, even though they're trying to eliminate mutants, there's like so many times where they could have killed Logan and they don't, like, or they could have at least injured him back. Like when they first run into him at his little house in Mexico, there's just probably 10 mercenaries around him with automatic rifles just pointing at him.
Yeah.
Then he just grabs the dude and he's about to claw him, and they just grab him. Like, no one shoots him. Like,
yeah.
And they know he's struggling, and they know they could have killed him. Like, there's just so many times where they could have killed him. I think they had a shotgun pointed. I think they had one point they were just like right over the top of him. They just could have killed him so easily.
Yeah.
And it was just kind of weird how they just kind of kept letting him live.
Right.
Even though they were trying to eliminate mutants. So it was kind of weird.
Yeah.
And That was kind of one of my little negatives on it.
The only thing I can think of is maybe they're still, because one of my questions, I guess, was how are they cloning these people? Right. You know, all of the people that they're trying to create and make into soldiers. At first, I was like, okay, because they're calling Logan X-23's dad, did he fucking go to a sperm bank or something?
No,
because
you haven't seen him X-Men Apocalypse.
Okay.
So the after credit scene shows Essex Corp, basically because he's Weapon X,
mm-hmm.
when he got the metal claws. They show, like, they got a bunch of vials of blood and shit like from all these different mutants and shit like that they've pulled blood from.
Okay.
So, and he was one of the ones they pulled blood from.
Gotcha.
And
So I wonder, because one of my other questions was, when she was first created, did she have the bone claws too? And then she had to go through the same thing he did in Origins?
That's what I think they were trying to show, because she was like laid on the bed and like they cut her open and stuff. I think they might have done a more direct approach than just injecting them and stuff like that. Because they showed that like all her body was cut open and shit.
Right.
And she's knocked out on the bed and they're inserting things and stuff like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, actually, okay, I forgot about that part. So I read this article that was talking about her and her origins and stuff like that. And it actually talks about that in the comics, because originally she started out as a character from a cartoon. And then right. it was similar to Harley Quinn. And then she went into the comics. And in the comics, they actually do take the claws out of her and then reinsert them as the antimanium.
Antimanium.
Yeah, whatever.
I think I was saying the metal. Right earlier. Yeah. really cool metal.
Yeah. So, I forgot about that part. So maybe that's what they did.
Yeah.
So that does kind of answer that question. Because I was just, there were certain things where I was like, what? How did this, just because she is a clone of him doesn't necessarily mean she's going to have those claws. She would have bones. And so, I was kind of confused with that. But going back to what you were talking about with Wolverine, I was thinking maybe they were trying to keep him alive, sort of, so that they could get more out of him and create more soldiers like her. But who knows?
Well, I mean, ultimately, and this is where we get into the X-24, which is a pretty much younger, almost exact clone of Wolverine.
Mm-hmm.
This is supposed to be the ultimate mutant, the ultimate super soldier that they wanted.
Right.
Is basically Wolverine. So it was kind of weird to me that they went through all this testing, they gave all these kids powers, and ultimately they just concluded that we need a Wolverine duplicate.
Yeah, a bunch of them.
Yeah.
Eventually.
And so I thought that was kind of odd. Like, I don't know why you just wouldn't start there. Like, it just seemed like to me you didn't have to go through 24 people to kind of figure that one out. I don't know, some of those other kids' powers seem pretty fucking awesome.
Yeah, I
it
wonder
like the one kid that was just like throwing motherfuckers up against the wall.
Yeah, I wonder if it was like had to do with control or something like that.
They had more control over him than they did the kids, obviously.
Yeah, so I wonder if that he I'm surprised for how old he is he wasn't X-1 because all the other kids are kids and he's a lot older.
Well, he's Project X.
So
he's the original Project X,
right? Okay,
so he would just be X, and then it'd probably be X-1, X-2, X-3, X-4.
Well, I thought X-24 was the name of the clone,
right? Who's older. I figured that meant there was 24 things before him.
Yeah, 24 iterations. But that
24 test subjects.
Yeah, that's the joke that I was making, is how come he's so much older if he's the 24th one?
Than all
the kids.
Yeah. Well, I think they, yeah, well, yeah. Well, I think he said that the kids were too, too erratic or something like that, too hard to control. So I think they just straight up, sped up, cloned, and made a guy.
That makes sense.
And made a dude out of it.
Yeah.
So we have the evil Wolverine. We had evil Goku and well, we have evil Superman from Superman 3.
Yep. Evil Darkwing Duck, Negaduck, I believe.
So that's how we're gonna do that. That's it was totally like Superman 3.
yeah, exactly.
He was just a total
splits
dick
apart
drinking liquor.
Tar
and so they have this badass fight. I don't know why, but I love, even though he was getting fucked up, Logan was, that initial fight when they just start going at it and they're just fucking slicing on each other. I was like, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
The rated R just brought it home.
Yeah, absolutely. Like,
these two dudes are just going nuts on each other.
Well, and I thought that helps kind of play into some of the emotion, is because you start feeling for Logan. I'm like, holy shit, how is he going to live, you know, right. through this. And he's just getting fucked up. Even at the fight at the end, yeah. he's just getting worked.
Yeah, he's getting the shit beat out of him.
Yeah.
And ultimately, the sad part, the black family dies.
Yeah.
The farmers. The like the only black farmer ever in the world.
Yeah. And he's the one who wants to stay like, no, yeah. we're not going to create corn. I'm going to grow it. You know, yeah. he's old school, which was cool. You know, they, and they had that wholesome family, you know, type thing. And,
right.
So yeah, it was awesome. Again, the supporting characters in this, I liked every single one of them. I thought it served a purpose. They did a really good job. The, Dr. Rice guy was a prick. The
cocky prick, like he just thought he was ultimately right.
Yeah, yeah, which was perfect. Man, yeah. yeah, which was perfect. Then the dude, I forgot his name already, but with the
Donald Pierce.
Yeah, yeah, with the cyborg hand, he was badass, a great character.
I thought he was just like an enjoyable prick.
Yeah,
like, he just had this tone to him, like he always, and he had the gold tooth and shit. So every time he smiled,
yeah, like, his dialogue was great.
Right, right, right. Yeah, it's just. Fuck, man, it's hard to even explain how fucking awesome this movie was. I loved pretty much every moment of it. You know, we had a couple things. I even had tits in it. Like, you can kind of love this movie.
Right.
I mean, it's momentary. It's kind of shit. It's kind of tinted a little bit, but it had tits in it.
Yeah.
Man. He's doing the limo driving. Well,
and that's the subtle humor is he kind of gives a smirk like, all right, sweet.
Hey, driver. What? I was like, I'm pretty sure. I'm not positive, but I'm pretty sure that's the first comic book movie to ever have tits in it like that.
Yeah.
Pretty positive.
Yeah.
Blade might have, and there might be some obscure other rated R movie I don't know. I don't think
we didn't get any in Deadpool.
Nothing in Watchmen, you know.
Yeah, no.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Deadpool. Strippers, when they're in the strip club, they're bouncing up and down.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
How did I forget that? That scene's awesome, too.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I completely forgot about
fucking
that.
Fucking go Fox, man. Putting tits in all your movies?
Yeah.
You're the man. That's how you do that shit, yep, man.
Yeah, exactly.
That's how you check off the three boxes. Language, blood, tits.
Yep.
Fucking perfect.
We're solid.
That's how you make a superhero movie. Yeah.
And just to make, you know, so that we could bring our wives along, they throw Ryan Reynolds' ass.
Oh, yeah. Up against a dirty-ass phone booth.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Oh, that was a great goddamn. I hope they adopt that. I'm sure other people are going to steal that shit now. But that little opening credit scene, you could call it, or whatever it is. Yeah, the preview, opening preview.
Yeah, because it was after the previews.
Yeah.
And it was tied into the movie because there's Logan and stuff like that. Yeah. And it was almost like a part of the movie.
Yeah, no, that was fantastic. That's I think, yeah, a lot more people should try that. Fox should keep that up somehow.
Yeah.
Do something with it.
That would be cool.
So there's a couple things that I did notice. We were talking about a little bit afterwards that we were trying to figure out when the kids got to this point after the border in Canada, like what stops them from.
Yes.
We were talking about this a little bit. I was doing a little bit of research on things, and it's speculation because of who he's trying to talk to on the other end. That one little kid, Victor, I think his name was. He was talking to somebody on the other end. And a lot of people were speculating that it was like there's this Canadian X-Men, I guess.
Okay.
And they might be very well known. It might even lead into something like this, apparently. And so it was it's digging, but it could make sense why they would be opposed to going across the border, the bad guys, because there could be these people that could whip their fucking ass.
Right. Okay. So but why wouldn't the Canadians come to? They're typical Canadians want to stay out of every war.
Well, all they got is forks and shit, plastic forks. Freeze. Actually, the person did give the explanation of, you know, because they technically work for the Canadian government, they can't oppose something in American soil. Okay.
All right. So that does kind of fill that in a little bit because they don't touch on that.
Close to right, but there's been hints in other. X-Men movies where they've been talking about this. I believe it's called X-Flight, is this group of people.
Okay, yeah, I've heard of that.
And they were kind of hinted at in other movies and some of the things. So it's kind of in the range of continuity with X-Men, which just doesn't make sense because, by the way, don't try to understand what timeline or time period this X-Men movie's in because it's fucked up. It's just think of it as its own movie, even though they make references to the first movie and Origins and a couple other
very
ones.
Very subtle ones.
Wolverine, yeah, it's like a samurai sword, the dog tags. Charles, you know, Xavier, he's talking about the cage fighting from the first movie. It was a, you know, they're all talking about it, but in the end, it doesn't almost make any sense.
Yeah.
Because the timelines are so messed up, it should be almost a completely different timeline.
Well, and I thought it was supposed to be significantly like, what was it, 2080 or something like that, or
2029. The problem is
2029. Is that recent?
I thought that's what they said.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe I missed that because I thought it was a little bit further, which sort of explained how he's aging. But I mean, he went like 200 years without aging before.
The problem is Days of Future Past is what's screwing this up now, because the way that movie ended was after he fixes the past, he pops up and this Xavier school is all to normal and everybody's alive again. Cyclops isn't dead. Jean's fine. Everybody's alive. Everybody's happy. And that's supposed to be like 2026. And there's kids running around the school and shit and stuff like that. So that's kind of where I think it was 2023 maybe. And so that's the one that kind of fucks everything up, because that was supposed to fix the continuity errors. And now because of this movie and other ones, it just fucked it all back up again.
And so, they don't know what they're doing.
So it's fantastic. Just enjoy it as a solo movie. Like, there's some mentions back to the previous movies, but they don't mean jack diddly shit. Other than
the subtle tie-ins to say, okay, it's same timeline.
X-Men. Other than Patrick Stewart and Hugh Jackman, that's the only tie-in to the fucking. They didn't even use the same actor from Days of Future Past that played Caliban. They used a different older guy to play Caliban, makes sense, but I mean, kind of, yeah, but because the Caliban was in Days of Future Past as the mutant tracker and stuff like that.
Okay.
Totally different actor.
Gotcha.
And apparently, somebody was saying that even though it's the same studio, the two guys didn't even talk to each other. They didn't even know, because Days of Future wasn't Days of Future Past. Scratch that. Apocalypse, X-Men Apocalypse. He was in X-Men Apocalypse.
Okay.
Caliban was. And I guess when the movies were being done, no one even talked to each other, so they just casted two different people same fucking role.
Right. Wow.
So it was just kind of, you know, Fox at its best, you know? Yeah. But, I mean, again, this movie is fantastic. If you saw it, I'm sure you loved it. If you didn't love this, please email us. Let us know what you thought was wrong with this. There's some people that thought they went too far, that it was too gruesome, that it was too hardcore. No. I saw a couple articles with that the X-24 character just slaughtering people and shit like that. But
that's the emotion that you need. You have to go, holy fuck. Like, when he steps out and he's going to come back, because they pretty much, he gets his head blown off by the shotgun, but then the guys go grab him, and you know that there's going to be another showdown between him and Wolverine. And when that happened, it was like oh fuck, here it comes. And you have to have that. You have to have him slaughtering the you know, all those guys. You have to show his power and how much rage he has when he fights Wolverine for the first time. You have to see, you know, of how much damage he can do to Wolverine. So by the time it gets to the final act, and you're just like, oh fuck, like, no, figure out something, because you're gonna get worked because of just how much. And they to me, you have to show that, and that's a part of the emotion that they pull out of this.
Well, I think it was also alluding to the fact that what Wolverine talks about later on, that everyone that gets close to him dies. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, even when he's trying to be nice to this family and this family's being nice to him, they die.
Yeah.
You know, Xavier dies because he thinks he's talking to Logan,
right?
And this dude is just sitting there over him and just slowly puts his hand on him, boom, just stabs him right in the chest. And that's how Xavier dies. And it's fucking an ending to a series, and an ending to the Logan Wolverine series, that is about as sad as it possibly can get.
Yeah.
But still has, you know, a future because of these young mutants.
Yeah, exactly. And to me, a fitting ending. I was thinking about, like, I wish they would have shown, you know, the kids get to wherever they were going, kind of, you know, close some holes there. But after thinking about it, the way the last shot
of the X.
Yeah, of her turning the cross into an X, and after he dies, panning out, it's 17 years of Hugh Jackman doing Wolverine. So it was just so fitting. He finally has been wanting to die, was wanting to die in the Wolverine, and then into this. And you can see he's getting to that point where he's just, I don't even know the word. Like,
well, he even says it at the end. He's like, this is what it feels like.
Yeah.
And it could be interpreted in like pain or death, mm-hmm. or, but I think it was more in towards that having a family, having appreciation, love for caring for someone.
Wow. Because, that's an interesting interpretation. Because
she was holding his hand and stuff, and he said, this is what it feels like. And I kind of, that's kind of how I originally took it. I mean, it could be the pain, the death thing.
That's how I took it, but your version's a lot more deeper.
That's how I am, man.
Yeah, pretty deep. I hate kids. I don't like kid actors, but, you know, this is how I, I interpreted it.
Did fantastic.
Yeah,
she did. I mean, she didn't have fucking, I don't know if they just had like a midget or something doing her action scenes or she did them or something like that. But, I mean, they didn't really do... It was a little jarring at first, those first couple fights, because it's hard to come out of John Wick and then watch this, right. Where John Wick is just like, they put a tripod up and they just like, go.
Yeah.
Like, there's no fucking quick cuts or anything like that. So the beginning was a little jarring for me because they were doing a little bit of cutting back and forth.
They held long enough.
That's what I mean. Like, she's flipping all over motherfuckers and stuff. And then she's on top of the Wolverine clone X-24 and she's just going to town.
Oh, yeah. That was fantastic.
And the motion on her face, she just did so well.
Yeah.
You could tell she's going to be such a bitch when she's older.
Once she was cast in this role.
She's just like, just going nuts and screaming. Awesome.
Yeah.
And she was just, fuck, yeah. They did cop out a little bit, though, when it came to the kid. Because the X-24 just backhanded her. It's like, come on. You've been slicing the fuck out of everybody.
Oh.
Bam!
Yeah.
But they didn't want to show a kid getting fucking...
mutilated.
Well, I guess they kind of did show those kids getting fucked up when they were chasing them through the woods.
Right.
Some of them were getting... That was the other thing that was a little weird for me. I don't know what exactly happened between what they were showing in some of the footage on that little cell phone thing. But these kids were like bred to be soldiers and like fighting machines. But then when they're getting chased, they're running like bitches. And so I thought that was kind of weird. I did think that was kind of weird. These kids have been almost bred and conditioned to not feel anything and just kill.
Right.
But they're running the whole time. I thought, I was like, fuck, why don't you guys just turn around and start?
Yeah, I was kind of waiting for that point, which you got it.
You got a little bit when they felt they needed to.
Right.
You know, the one girl blows ice and shatters the dude's arm.
Yeah, which that was awesome. And then the Victor guy, I think his name was, he flips the truck.
Yeah,
and crushes X-24.
Then he just fucking waves that shit off like it don't matter.
Yeah, I dust my shoulders off and here I come.
But man, when he's fucking up Logan, man, he just drives him, throws him on the tree trunk part. Yeah. Just it's like there ain't no healing from that motherfucker.
Nope.
and she just pops him with the revolver, with the fucking adamantium bullet.
Yeah, which is awesome.
Yeah, this whole movie is just fucking great. Yep. I don't know, you know, it should make over $100 million. I don't know what you people are waiting for.
No kidding.
You know, it's got great subtle humor, great action, tits. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
You can't do any better than this. I don't even know. Honestly, I was thinking about the score, and I'm like, I don't even know what the fucking score of this movie.
Yeah.
Because there's so little wrong with it, and it's just so great.
Yeah.
And
this is going to be, I said this walking on the theater too, this is going to be hard to beat. And I get that you can't compare Spider-Man Homecoming to Logan.
I'm going to. You wait. When we do Spider-Man Homecoming, I'm going to compare every scene.
I was going to say, one of the best fucking parts of Lego Batman was like 2.6 or whatever.
2.4.
Yeah, okay, right. 2.4. If you're fucking damn score on that movie. So yeah, I guess we can.
What? That was a great score. That is a great score.
It's fitting. We give our kids scores, and you're like, no, fuck that, 2.6. But anyways, I get that, you know, it's hard to compare all of, you know, we have Justice League and Power Rangers and all these movies that are coming out. It's hard to compare when you have this rated R. But like I said at the beginning, this, to me, it's everything that I would want in a movie. You know, just throw in Superman and you're solid. But
then you wouldn't have a cool road trip. Superman would just fly.
He's like, I'm here. There you go.
That movie would end a lot shorter.
Yeah. You wouldn't get the emotion.
Speaking of Superman, I just wanted to bring up something because it was both you and I's reaction to seeing the Deadpool teaser thing in the beginning was, how did they get the Superman music?
Yeah, well, I
actually looked up an article because I was that interested.
Okay.
I had to know. Apparently, it's not necessarily WB that owns that or DC Comics. It's Donner Productions.
Really?
With John Williams' score.
Okay.
So they got permission from one of the Donner siblings, the trust or whatever that's built up.
Okay.
They got permission. They must have gotten permission from them to use their music.
Okay.
So it wasn't WB or anything like that. I thought that was amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, really, it was perfect. I love that beginning thing. And then he's like, why is there a phone booth?
And yeah, then they'll shit go the out in 1998.
Yeah. this is perfect. Yeah, so anyways, it's it is hard to score this. I roughly gave it, I think, a 4.7. It just knocked it down a little bit because there was stuff that was kind of left out in the open, but damn near perfect. Damn near anything I would want in a movie. I love movies like Deadpool and, you know, the humor and stuff like that, but the emotional roller coaster that you go on in every aspect, they have, you know, the humor, there's the action, there's, like you said, the tits.
Good tits, too.
Yeah, exactly. They,
perky.
And then they, you know, they have the connection, they have the, like, a father-son connection, they have a father-daughter connection, and then you get the death. It's, like, literally everything that you could possibly think of is in this movie, so well done. And yeah, that's the only score I could kind of come up with of like, well, they left a little bit out there, but I don't see what people couldn't like about this movie.
Unless you're a pussy. I mean, I get that. Like, if you're like a pussy, oh, blood, no.
Yeah.
Bad language. No, they said fuck at least like 30 times.
Right. It's definitely not a Lego Batman. It's not, you know, or a Marvel movie.
I think Lego Batman had more dick jokes than
Logan. That's true. Yeah. So it's not made for the general audience. So I guess if you aren't into these type of movies, then don't go watch it. But please don't hope that they bring X-Men to that side. We'll have to bring our good friend Nick, who's a huge X-Men fan, to see what he thinks, because he's also a huge Marvel Disney fan as well. So
loser.
he'll be on a future podcast, so we'll have to ask.
Yeah, eventually we're hoping to look back and we're going to review some of the Wolverine movies.
Yep.
I think we're going to do both.
Yeah.
I think we're going to do Origins and the Wolverine in honor of Logan.
Yes.
So we're going to review that and see how that goes.
Yep.
Even talk about maybe a tad bit about Logan
mm-hmm.
and that one as well. Even though we just talked about it in length here. Yeah. And like, I just keep thinking of all the awesome things that happened in the movie.
Yeah.
The fucking very beginning with the Mexican dudes. You're going to strip them. They're chrome lugs. Like, yeah. And then he just fucking pulls the shotgun out.
He's like, calls come him a, on, guys.
Calls him a, the guy's like, bendejo. And it's like, I'm like, wow, man. These guys are determined for rims.
Yeah,
dude.
Seriously.
Like, I was like, at this point, you just shot the dude. Just steal the car. Like, yeah, why are you still trying to take the tires off? It's a nice-ass Cadillac limo.
Oh, my God.
Just steal the fucking car.
That was one of the best parts, too. After he just demolishes almost all the guys, the one guy that makes it back to the van, or actually, I think there were two, all the doors are still open from them leaving, and they're just
like, pulling off. He's trying to protect the car and shit. Not the car!
Yeah, fuck. Pulls it up to the casino, leave it on the street, or whatever, leave it on the curb. It's just fucking beats the shit.
That was great.
Oh,
once again, great movie. Please go see it. My score is going to be, I'm going to say 4.6.
Okay.
I'm going to go 4.6 just because there's no perfect movie, even though I really love this movie. And so it's a tad bit better than Deadpool for me. It basically just popped into that almost that number one spot for me for best comic book movie ever, you know? Like for me, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic movie. Go
so
see
so glad it.
It
lived up to the hype because I was worried. And maybe that's what helped is I was going in like, oh, we'll see, fuckers.
Yeah.
We created a whole podcast off of everyone else's opinions. So let me be the judge. And yeah, any review or whatever, any score that I saw before lived up to it. So
right. No, most people gave it a pretty solid score. I remember seeing the trailers. The only thing that worried me was the kid. Like I didn't really want to deal with a kid actor and stuff, but she did fantastic. She didn't say anything, which is great. And so till the very end. And most of it was in language I don't understand. So perfect.
Yeah, exactly.
But I was surprised all the other kids spoke English so well. And she was the only one that didn't. Anyway, so that concludes this episode.
Hold on. So I'm going to give it a 4.5. That's so true. Maybe they're Canadian. I don't know.
All the other kids from the same Mexico City fucking place spoke English just fine. She was the only one.
I didn't even notice that. You're so right. Anyways.
So that concludes this review of Logan. Go fucking see it.
Yes.
Right fucking
fuck
now.
Yes.
Please. Please go see it.
Finish this podcast. We got some more plugs to do. And go see it.
Yeah. Plugging away here. So make sure you check out that YouTube page that gets updated every 3 months at Comic Movie Marks. Be that 28th subscriber. And we will do our questionnaire.
Yes.
Email us at comicmoviemarks@gmail.com.
There you go.
For any questions.
Yes. You can also post questions or whatever on all of our social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Be sure to follow us along on there. We update a little bit more. We're, you know, starting to actually get some interaction, which is awesome.
Yeah, the Instagram page is starting to take off.
Yeah. Woo! 100 followers.
Hey, they're genuine, damn it. Only like 50 of them sell knives. So.
Right. Or say, want more followers?
Oh, God. What? And then you click on them and they have zero followers. It's like, what? Oh, it's like, man. The people on YouTube. You know how you get more views and then they have like 100 views on their video?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, way to go, thanks. Guys. You really showed me how to do it.
Jerk off. Oh, man.
Fucking stupid asses. Oh, yeah. Tinder porn websites. Okay.
Yes. So, actually, on that note, I did look into Tinder. You have to link it to a personal Facebook page. So I don't know how we would do that, but we'll figure it out. We'll be on Tinder.
So wait, our Facebook page isn't considered a personal Facebook page?
No, it's a company ran by, a company, a business or whatever, ran by a personal Facebook page.
Oh.
Yes. Okay. So it has to be linked. I tried. I really did. I was like, I'm going to fucking do this.
Let's just make a personal one and just call it Comic Movie Marks.
Yeah, there we go.
We're Movie Marks, goddammit.
Yeah, exactly.
And my name's boom, Mark.
Link Tinder to
his
it.
His name's Movie.
We're the Movie Marks. Fuck, what don't you get?
This is only goes two ways here. And it makes you look like a pig on a rotisserie. Anyway, make sure... So check us out on Tinder coming soon. We're gonna figure this out.
Yes, we will. We'll be on there.
We're gonna fucking break this bitch wide open, if you get what I mean.
Yes, on Tinder.
Oh, God damn it, we're so immature. That's for the rated R Logan review.
Yes.
So, in case I don't see you.
Good afternoon, good evening, and good night. Logan.